I'm indeed very thankful to this gracious invitation extended by the chairman of the ORFR and the Dr. Kulkarni Sahab. I have been here on the other occasion also, and therefore I'm indeed very thankful for offering me this platform to share my this perspective on the issue that has really caught the attention of the world for a reason that the issue which is absolutely embedded in this is not only raises the whole question of democracy and the civil society, but probably this is for the first time in the history where the state has come out very strongly against a faith-based civil society movement, which is in popular terms called Gulen movement or Hijmat movement, which over the last 50 and 60 years of its existence has impeccable records of the peace buildings. There is not a single instance and the evidence where the elements of the movement has been formed in any kind of the violent activities. And therefore, it raises more the question when the state actually blamed directly without losing any point of time and hurriedly and rushing to the press and declaring Gulen movement behind this failed military coup. And it is this allegation, I suppose, actually, it is this allegation and not in itself what happened into the names of the military and the failed military coup, because where we are reaching at the end of the 21st century, that there is certainly the global aspirations in the favor of the democracy and the democratic rule. And speaking from certainly from that kind of the global aspiration of democracy and a democratic rule, we certainly need to condemn any kind of the illegitimate takeover by the state, actually. And therefore, we should really condemn. And therefore, we are with those voices of the Turkish people that resolutely rejected any kind of the failed military coup. But the second part of this failed military coup is that where the state actually came down heavily on the followers of the Gulen movement, accusing of its direct involvement, and not only accusing, even for example, starting the witch hunting, which ultimately led to the tens and the thousands of the members who were working in the states and the judiciary and the military and this and that. I am the one who has been researching on the Gulen movement by virtue of my position in a Zirve University as a professor and later with the Fatih University as a visiting professor. I have been staying in this country over the last 4 and 5 years, actually. And I have an opportunity, and I think that fortunate enough to see the Turkish society very closely and have my own observation, which I would like to record here. It's number one, the peculiarity which is very much involved in this kind of crisis is this, that never in the history a military coup has failed. So when a military coup actually takes place, and it is not for the first time that this is the military coup that has happened in the history of the, there has been the military coup in the 60s and 70s and 80s and 1998 and what is called even the postmodern coup, actually. So there has been a military coup without actually military participating in the coup in Turkey, and the government has lost and the government has been overthrown. You know, in 1998, actually, Erbakan government, in fact. This is not for the first time. So my first contention is that, and that has also been the universally recognized, the military coup normally doesn't fail. The second is, no military coup, whether it fails or it succeeds, ever in the history has been called as a terrorist. There's a linkage. Terrorists are normally non-states activists, actually, with record of the violence and the participation and this and that. You have a minimum definition of the terrorism. Never into the history, actually, where the military coup fails or succeeds. Nobody dubbed Pervez Musharraf as a terrorist, actually. Let's be very honest and let's be very frank, actually. And this actually raises a question. And third, which is probably much more perplex and much more complicated, why did actually the state choose a Gulen movement, which has otherwise the record of the peace building, which has otherwise the record of the a kind of the movement which is otherwise what has come to known as a moderate Islam, you know, but otherwise in terms of the Islamic category, there's nothing exit this kind of definition, radical or moderate and this and that. But certainly into the English public sphere, the movement has been recognized as a kind of the moderate Islam, which promotes common brotherhood, which promotes tolerance, which promotes cooperations, which promotes peace buildings, which promotes interfaith dialogues. And this is also the remarkable movement over the last in the 40 and 50 years, has made its presence over more than 150 countries, running thousands of the secular educational institutions. This is indeed a movement remarkable. It is probably only Islamic movements in the world that is running the secular educational movements. It has a heavy presence in the higher education, into the elementary educations with its own follow. And the movement has never been into the business of making madarsas in the mosque, precisely because it has denotes understanding. One understanding is that it has come to realize that education is the central tenet of a faith. Without education, you cannot realize a faith. The second, the movement has come to realize that the whole distinctions and the whole differences that has come to stay in a Muslim society over what is called the Islamic educations and the Western secular education is actually a false. The Muslim society over the last 400 and 500 years has been suffering with this kind of distinction, that there is something called the Islamic education and there is something called the secular educations. And the Muslims should seek an Islamic education or should give more premium and more values to Islamic education over any kind of secular educations. In Gulen's Islamic thinking, there's no some compartmentalization between religion and the secular, but rather the secular is very much part of the religious understanding of the universe. And the second, he has actually come to believe that it is not the question of the Islamic education, but education is an Islamic values. And once you switch over this paradigm, education is an Islamic value, then you could be dancer, you could be musician, you could be singer, you could be anything. It's a whole question of the skills that you appropriate, and which is extremely important, in fact. The movement actually originated within the Turkey, and slowly and gradually it has become the global movement. I do not want to go into the history. Probably we'll take up the question on cessation, in fact. But what was really remarkable is that within the Turkey extents, over the last 30 and 40 years, the movement has become a very nationwide and nationalist social movement, actually, and thrives on the donation of the people, what you call basically zatka and sadaka, and that money was basically transferred to building the peace-building process, educational institution, tolerance, you know, interfaith dialogues, and other kinds of the all humanistic cooperations, in fact. The fundamental question here is that why the state has chosen this movement, not only to criminalize it, but also basically to delegitimize it of any kind of Islamic identity, in fact. And I think is that you do find that the state has, over the last 4 and 5 years, and since in December, this is not for the first time, actually. If anybody who is a keen observer of Turkish politics, actually, since the corruption cases that have actually emerged, and let me tell you here, because now it is official, actually, that in 2004, when the AKP government came into the power, there was an agreement between the military and the AKP government led by Erdogan that what to do with the Gulen movement, actually. Because in the secular psyche and the Kemalist understanding, actually, while we can defeat the AKP actually in the electoral or any kind of, for example, democratic politics, it is extremely difficult for this the knowledge-based educational movement, which has become increasingly the face of the Turkey actually, and which has basically become the part and the parcel of the state institution, in fact. It is true that large number of the Gulen followers as a member of Turkish society, as a citizen of Turkey, they are embedded in the bureaucracy, and they may be into the military, and they may be in judiciary, and they may be into the educational institution. But what's harm in it? I am here being reminded that, let's say for example, that because the place, Sayyid Shahabuddin, a very celebrated Indian foreign officer, the latter took even to the politics actually, later on actually. So when he got into the Indian Foreign Services, everybody knows that he was a cardholder communist person actually. He was the communist cardholder man. And that created a serious problem for his appointment in the IFS. And that time, the Jawaharlal Nehru actually took a position that everybody is free as far as the ideas is concerned, unless and until it actually contradicts to the state or the national interest, and therefore he was allowed to join. Now the position is this, that the government, the Turkish government, has accused the Gulen movement of state within the state, or what is called the parallel structures. You know, that essentially means that the state actually believes that the large number of the cadres and the large number of followers in the military and judiciary, they are not following the state orders, but they are following the orders from the Gulen who are sitting into America actually. Now this is the discourse. This discourse is not something very recent actually. This discourse has a remarkable legitimacy within the Muslim society. This discourse has a remarkable legitimacy within the Islamic civilization. All of you remember that how Nasir actually accused the Muslim Brotherhood in early 1940s, saying state within the state, and crass that the entire structure of the Muslim Brotherhood. But there's a remarkable distinction between the pattern of the Muslim Brotherhood and Fatehullah Gulen movement in a sense that whereas the Muslim Brotherhood, or what is called Ikhwan in Egypt, is avowedly political, is avowedly ideological, and is avowedly believed in the faith of the Islamic State and committed for the creation of Islamic State, neither from the Gulenist discourse, nor all kinds of the literatures, nor from any kind of the activities, it actually come out that this movement has very much dedicated, or for example, working for any kind of the caliphate, or for any, rather, for example, the Gulen, time and again it has taken a position that the era of caliphate or era of, for example, Islamic State is basically over. Nobody can reverse any kind of democracy as such. That is the position the Gulen has historically actually taken. But nonetheless, you do find that this kind of discourse has survived within the Muslim societies and has become acceptable precisely for a reason that in a Muslim society, a state really enjoys a remarkable legitimacy because of the particular historical traditions of the building of the states. My friends, I would like to say is that the state, an English word, may be universal category, applicable to the different places, but let me also take this position that the cultural imagination of a state varies from one society to another society. And that makes the whole understanding of a state particularly differences, in fact. And therefore, what happened is that in particularly in the Turkish legal sale of the oil during the Ahmadinejad government in exchange for the gold, actually, and now the kingpin of this Zarab is very much in the US custody, in fact, in America, actually. You know, so there is the whole history actually. Now what is very interesting is that even in 2013 and 2014 actually, Erdogan actually won the election by the 52%, and then the Erdogan actually realized that he's above party, above state, above nation, and he is above nation, and therefore what is this prime minister and president? I should be the leader of the nation. In the Muslim imaginations, the leader carries a special word actually. The prime minister may be post, president may be post, but the leader is something very different. Informally, within Turkey, Erdogan is absolutely called, he is basically called, what you say, I'm just forgetting the word. He's called basically, what is the word I'm just forgetting? The leader in the, Reis. He is called Reis. And therefore, as of now, at one point of during the time of the Iranian revolutions, in 1979 and post-79, there used to be the Imam line. Today in Turkey, there's a Reis line. Everybody has to follow the Israelis. Whether this, and therefore what you find very interesting is that with this emergence of this mega personality, how is it that the same Turkey that actually witnessed a remarkable degree of economic development, that actually witnessed a remarkable advancement in the democratic field right from 2002 to 2012. And then in the post-corruption issues, the same Turkey actually moved in a very high intensity and a very high order towards the authoritarian polity, actually. All opposition paper was shut down, actually. Twitter's account, Facebook, other kind of the social media, the government today control the 90% of the medias, all opposition television has actually been shut down, and you see very remarkable that the very authoritarian kind of tendencies emerging within Turkey, actually. You know, the questions, and till date, the question raises that here is a person who is extremely popular, actually. There is no doubt about that. Who really enjoys the huge mandate, but at the same time, it's becoming too authoritarian. What makes the person become too authoritarian, and what makes the person does not have a confidence in its own institution? Because till date, Erdogan and his regime has not conducted any judicial investigation of the corruption cases. In India, we are accustomed with corruption every day, and none of our politicians would dare to take a position that this corruption is basically a civilian coup. It's a judicial coup. I have never heard any of our politicians, when they get involved in a corruption cases, the Indian politician would invariably take a position, please institute a CBI inquiry and the law will take its own course. No manage, our politicians are very good in managing the commission, that's a different story, or it will take 10 to 12 years actually, or 20 years. But here is a situation where a man who is at the helm of affairs will prefer a parliamentary kind of investigation, but will be afraid of any kind of the independent judicial investigation. And the same pattern is again being revolved when this failed military coup actually takes place, that where again the government is reluctant to going for the independent judicial investigation, whether domestically or internationally. Because Fatehullah Gulen has called for the international judicial commission to be set up, and if he found guilty, he should be punished or his followers should be punished. But the government is reluctant to have any kind of judicial investigation domestically, and therefore he is again going for any kind of the parliamentary investigations, actually. As far as I am concerned, my understanding is this, but let me, before I come, you need to really understand this state and state within the state, that you maybe have a very good image of Kemal Ataturk. There is no doubt about that. A great modernizer, a great reformers. We have a Kemal Ataturk road also in Delhi, there's absolutely no doubt. But let me tell you, this could be the external perception of a father of a nation, of a Turkey, actually. But as far as the internal perception of a father of nation is concerned, that is completely different. The internal perception of Kemal Ataturk is the one who basically criminalizes Islam, who basically try to eliminate Islam, who try to Turkify each and everything, actually, and who actually see to it that the Muslim majority and people with a Muslim faith should not in a position to join, and therefore there has been the legal discrimination against the Muslim majority. During the Kemalist period, right from the 1923 up to the AKP coming to the power, it is the first nation that was governed by the minority and not by the majority, actually. And who happened to this minority? This happened to be the leftist. This happened to the sectional whites. This happened to be the Kemalist. This happened to be the secularist, who actually control military, bureaucracy, and judiciary, and rule by virtue of force and by virtue of law without any kind of the popular consent, actually. Erdogan is certainly far more powerful than Kemal is, because he not only have a control over the military, judiciary, and the other organ, but he is also backed by the popular support, which the Kemalists did not have, that actually makes him far more invincible than even in that kind of setups. It was in this situation that the Gulen actually emerged, asked the Muslim families and the Muslim parents to send their children to the education, because the point was similar like this. It was like an Indian Muslim situation. Because I remember there was a government school nearby my home in Gaya, actually, and none of the Muslim parents sent their children to that school. It was a Hindu school, precisely on the fear, because sending the children will compromise the faith in that school, actually. The Islam will not be safe. you know. Well, we were lucky that my parents actually sent me to the convent school. That's a different issue. But the large number of the Muslim families was very much afraid in India. And the business of the government is basically to open educational institution. The business of the government is not that you are Muslim, so we will open your home. स्कूल खोलेंगे और आप हिंदू हैं तो हम आपके घर में स्कूल खोलेंगे द बिजनेस ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट इज ओनली टू ओपन स्कूल्स एंड योर जॉब इज टू गो एंड टेक द एडमिशन सिमिलर सिचुएशन हैपन इन टर्की लार्ज नंबर ऑफ अनातोलियन मुस्लिम्स सन द केमालिस्ट स्कूल्स एंड द केमालिस्ट एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूशंस एंड एज अ रिजल्ट द अलवीज एंड द लेफ्टिस्ट एंड द सेक्युलर हु जॉइन दे गेट इन टू द स्टेट पावर इट इज ओनली विद द गुलेन्स And the Gulen's, for example, motivations, asking its people to enter into the educational institution, that your Islam is not going to compromise, that the Gulen had been in a position to promote and ever develop a very remarkable faith-based social movement. And because of that, Muslim for the first times in Turkey become much more competitive to secular, to Kemalist, to leftist, and enter into the large number of the state sectors, actually. Now, state actually accused them of the parallel structure. State actually accused them, state within the state, where should they will go? Are they not entitled to become district magistrate? Are they not entitled to become the member of the military officer? Are not they entitled to become of the judiciary? Are they, if they are a Turkish citizen, and as a citizen, they have a similar rights to enter into the job resources as any other, actually. And to be honest, actually, this is the only movement in the Islamic world that has produced its cadre and the followers linking with the employment opportunities. One of the problem with Jamaat-e-Islami or Tablighi Jamaat, any radical Islam or Taliban, or for example in Pakistan, that these Islamic movements have produced a large number of, for example, army that does not have any connection with the global opportunity structure. Since they do not have any connection with the global opportunity structure, they are much used by any kind of radical ideology, by any court, and therefore, as a result, what happened? The terrorism industry absolutely, it basically thrives. But with the Gulenist, large number of the followers which they have produced, they are the part of the global economic structure within Turkey, outside Turkey's, running the schools, and therefore, they are not, for example, susceptible to any kind of the radical influence which normally grows in the context of marginalization as such. So that's what the Gulen movement actually did, in fact. Now, as far as my own contention is that I do believe this coup must have been generated by a section of the Kemalist, I believe, because almost all the previous coups has been done because the military remained the only stronghold there of Kemalist institutions, you know. And the military has always intervened in 60s and 70s and 80s and the 90s in the name of arresting the growth of Islamization, in the name of arresting the growth of the any kind of, for example, the visible dimension of the Islam. One needs to really investigate. Now, here is a situation that the state has completely ruled out the policy. Why the state will rule out the possibility? A state would like to explore the multiple possibilities. How that the state will come out with a one single factor that this is being done by the Gulen movement, actually, you know. The reason is basically very simple. That why it target the Gulen movement and why it is not targeting the Kemalist movement is that the first of all is that the Gulen movement is very much nationalist movement, actually. It is a die-hard nationalist movement. And it is precisely die-hard nationalist movement that these Turkish people and these followers of Gulen movement who are running their schools and their colleges, they always introduce Turkish as their language in their school because of the love of their country, actually. And the way nationalism has been constructed in Turkey, the bane of that nationalism is linguistic nationalism. It is the Turkish nationalisms, you know. And the Gulen movement itself has been remarkable nationalist. He has gone even to the extent of saying, if there would have been the choice, if the choice would have been available before me to read Quran in Turkish, I would have preferred that. But since the Quran is in Arabic, I do not have any alternative but to read in Arabic, actually. But if that would have been in Turkish, I would have preferred that. And his understanding is that why he would have preferred reading Quran in Turkish, because his understanding is this, that the Ottoman Empire has been the empire of the tall and a very romantic idea of the tolerance and civilization and other things, and therefore the Quran would have been much more understood from the Ottoman kind of the background. So he would prefer. So he has been a thoroughly nationalist. Now what happened in Turkey is actually is that there are two specific features in the Middle Eastern politics. The first specific feature in the Middle Eastern politics is this, is number one is that no matter how secular government you are, no matter how nationalist government you are, Islam continued to be the legitimacy of the state. And over the years within Turkey, Erdogan has emerged more as a religious leader than as a political leader. Large number of majority of the Turkish people actually has come to believe that Erdogan actually enjoys a blessing of divinity, and therefore Turkey is developing much more actually faster. Now given a situation actually that Erdogan actually represents two trends. One trend is that certainly is that he is representing the Muslim majority of Turkey actually, or what is called, for example, the Black Turks in the Turkish language actually, because they're coming from agriculture, other less educated, so reporting that black majority. In Indian metaphor, you can really understood that it's a kind of the, for example, Mandal commissions or the revolt of the OBCs against the upper caste of the any kind of the hegemony. It is in this situation that both the Gulen movement and the AKP certainly represented the whole question of the equity and justice, remarkably. And they actually push the agenda together of the equity and justice. But where was Erdogan was actually representing the whole question of in the image of the Islam and development, Gulen movement also represented Islam and development. This is the Islamic movement, not without any face of development. This is the Islamic movement which for the first time into the history created the examples of running hundreds and thousands and successful educational institutions. And Gulen educational institutions in Turkey is not like a Sisu Mandir, or is not like, for example, you know, like any kind of the madrasas. It is like, for example, modern schools, like, for example, any top brass probably into the Mumbai actually, or for example, Delhi public school, or any other kind of the convent school, in which whether you are atheist, whether you are leftist, whether you are a secularist, whosoever you are, you will prefer your children sending to that school. That's the remarkable professionalism, and that's the remarkable brand that they actually develop. And the Guleni schools and wherever, they don't actually teach any kind of the religion actually, but this school actually become a model of the excellence, actually become the model of the professionalism because of their hard working and for whatever the reasons. So this was the school that was created. This was the university that was actually created, but it was actually created and in order to demonstrate that the Muslim could do it. Because over the last 405 years, a situation has come to exist where Islam and science has become antithetical. Islam is opposed to development. Islam is opposed to progress. Islam is opposed to science. How are you going to deal with this kinds of the global image of the Islam? What Fatehullah Gulen actually did in this context is that the first for two decades, like the 70s and the 80s and the early 90s, he actually produced a battery of the teachers only to teach a science, physics, chemistry, and mathematics, no social sciences, so that the misperception that the Muslims are thoroughly incapable of teaching science should went down. And therefore, large number of teachers we find we working, they are mostly coming from the science background. Because Fatehullah Gulen, in the context of Turkey, and in the context of Turkey, the state has been into the business of criminalizing Islam. The state has been in the business of demonstrating that Turkey has become backward because of the Islam, and that is why Fatehullah Gulen actually insisted, let there be a Muslim teacher of physics, a Muslim teacher of mathematics, a Muslim teacher, and should be in a position to become an example, and they should become the visible. Given this situation that you have the Islam and development generated by or represented by Erdogan actually, similarly, Gulen also was representing Islam and development. And therefore, there was already an innate tensions within these two movements that who is going to upper hand actually. The second, which is actually very important, is that into the Middle Eastern context actually, that there is an inherent tendency that the state would like to monopolize the political public space. Any state would like to monopolize public space. That the state will not willing to concede this space to any opposition and to any others. Fortunately or unfortunately, over the years, the Gulen movement, the only movement that become overtly visible, I would say. It's not merely visible, but it was overtly visible. It has a Jaman newspaper, it has a Today's Jaman, that has a circulation in the millions. The largest circulating newspaper belonged to Jaman. The largest television viewer belonged to Gulen movement. The number of schools, the largest, belonged to the Gulen movement. The largest private university actually belonged to the Gulen movement. Its own, for example, KMCU-MOOC, which is basically the aid organization, which is absolutely the relief organization, it actually got the membership of the United Nations Journalists and Writers Foundation. It got the members of the United Nations Social and the Economic Councils. It acquired those international brands. So it became overtly visible. It was backed by the large number of the industrial houses. This visibility itself in the due course of time actually created a fear, to my understanding, within the establishment, that if not today, tomorrow you will take over. Right now you are saying that you have nothing to do with politics, you are away from politics, but there is no guarantee, because unfortunately, within the Islamic history, all Islamic movement has been geared to acquire political power. So that tradition also does not instill a confidence where you can really imagine of a movement that would be totally devoid of any kinds of the idea of the power, you know. And therefore, there was this fear, because the Muslim, all the examples, you have the Muslim Brotherhood coming into the state actually, you know. Jamaat-e-Islami working very hard in Pakistan, Jamaat-e-Islami working very hard in Bangladesh. The only difference is that you are claiming that you will not commit, therefore you are an invisible force. The state would certainly would like to accuse you. The third factor, which is extremely important, is that why the state actually target the Gulen movement actually is that, because as long as the Gulen movement remain a very nationalist with a positive image, the threat will continue. And therefore, once the military coup actually take place, this is the only occasions, use it to the extent that actually made the Gulen movement as an anti-national forces. Today, the Gulen movement has become an anti-national forces within a Turkish setup. That the way the actually state has used and rather, for example, misused the whole idea of terrorism. And therefore, what you find is that the opposition party, CHP and the MH party, everybody for the first time has accused the Gulen movement involvement in the military coup. The reason is very simple. Because the CHP is the largest opposition party and most of their members and most of their vote bank and most of their support actually are coming from the Alawites, coming from the Kemalists, and it is these people who have the heavy presence in the military institutions. You know, and therefore they find it's a very soft target, and all the opposition and everybody has actually jumped. And the whole idea is that not only to deprive of the Gulen movement, not only to remove any kind of the, he has been not declared false prophet, this prophet, he has been declared within Turkish press as a someone who is not Muslim and this and that, is not only robbed of Islamic identity, but also robbed of its nationalistic credentials actually. So that it completely ceased to any kind of the threat for the state in the future, in fact. The last factor why the state has actually succeeded actually is that, is to be honest, that you need to really understand that it has particularly to do with the particular historical traditions of making the state in the Middle Eastern histories, actually. That for all practical purpose, the national perception is that the state is basically father agencies. State is Erdogan, anybody who represents a father figure. And the citizens are basically children. So it's a very kind of the patronizing discourse. And in this setup, there is very powerful conviction among the people actually that whatever they have and how far they have developed the economic development, it's all because of the state. And therefore, a state has a right to give you and a state has a right to take it back. As a result, what you find very interesting is that with the emergency state law that has been declared in Turkey on the pretext of this failed military coup, in one night, Erdogan took over more than 5,000 educational institutions belong to the Gulen movement, actually, including my university, Zirve University. As of now, my university is closed, but my contract says that I'm a professor, so I'm technically, it is here, I'm a professor. But as of now, the educational institution has been closed on. Now imagine a situation, a decision has been taken overnight. My university has a 10,000 students, other university will have a 10,000. So why do it's completely kind of madness? How would you do this? Simply in the public perception, it says it's a Gulen link. And imagine a situation from where the state has the capacity, then within 2 days of the military coup, you actually dismiss and remove more than 1 lakh people. From where do you find? That essentially means the list has been prepared. Nothing else. How would you find it otherwise? And this is not problematic that the list has not been prepared. Because if you look at the role of the intelligentsia, or what is called into Arabic, like for example, Mukhabarat. Nobody understands the meaning of state in the Middle Eastern politics. Everybody understands Mukhabarat. So, spies. So Mukhabarat could be in family, Mukhabarat could be educational institution, Mukhabarat will be the brother, could also be the Mukhabarat. Therefore, what you find, that the entire society within Turkey and there are extremely polarized, are extremely distrustful. Nobody would be in a position to talk to each other in a very normal way, in fact. And their state intelligentsia, MIT in Turkey, has a very old record of profiling people. We have all been profiled. Since you all be profiled, all institutions have been profiled over the years. No wonder that the government has list, and therefore it can close down more than 5,000 educational institutions. Because these educational institutions are very much in public sphere, schools are in public sphere, press is in public sphere, universities, there's nothing hiding there actually, operating as per law. What is worse in this scenario is that because of this, the civil society organization actually enjoys, the civil society organization enjoys a very less legitimacy compared to the legitimacy of the state. State really enjoys a remarkable legitimacy because of their own cultural tradition, because of their own history, where state is actually considered as a kind of provider to the entire society, in fact. And that's actually gave a wedge to this. It is in this situation, actually, the whole questions of the future of democracy becomes extremely fragile and extremely problematic. For a reason is that, because what is happening as of now, because Turkey as an state has been, I'll just take a couple of minutes, 2-3 minutes, that Turkey is the one country among the Muslims which has been hailed by the West and probably one of the earliest one on the path of modernity and modernization. One of the earliest one. It has all ingredients in terms of imitations of the European cultures, in terms of imitations, it's a highly imitative societies actually. Remarkable habits and remarkable manners. And the remarkable, for example, the Western race and each and everything. So it has all the ingredients to be identified because madrasa has been closed, Sufi shrine has been closed, totally being secularized, women has been totally liberalized. The only ingredient it doesn't have to qualify as a modern was democracy. Kemalist modernization was basically authoritarian modernization. It was not a democratic modernization at all, actually. So the only criteria where the Turkey was unable to come as a modern vision was basically it was not democratic. It has its own military. Even at that time, large number of intelligentsia used to take a pride itself that our military is different than the other post-colonial societies. Our military come, fix the problem, and then go back to barrack. It's not like Pakistan. So please, yaar, we are not Pakistan. We are not Malaysia, we are not other countries. Hamara dekhiye military bichara aata hai, fix karta hai, barrack mein chala jata hai na. So we are very much modern. The only thing was lacking is this democracy. And this democracy actually came 2002 and this and that. And then what you find very interesting as of now, the large number of Turkish intelligentsia and Turkish people and Turkish opinion makers are today actually struggling. Why the international community is not conferring the legitimacy of recognizing their resistance to the military coup as something a democratic, which the international community actually recognized in the context of the Arab Spring. That is the fundamental question in a Turkish society, because we have resisted these military forces actually, you know. And then why the international community has not rushed to Ankara? Why the US has not rushed? Why the Europeans are skeptical? Even all the mature democracy, even in India, are very much skeptical, because all the circumstantial evidence actually point out the elements of the state, or very much the involvement of the state in creating these kinds of the national crisis. So they are very much skeptical and conferring these kinds of the legitimacies actually. And the second was is that the state actually took upon to declare and to brand Gulen movement not for example anything other than a terrorist. How would you brand a movement who does not have a single evidence of participation of any kind of the violence, who has a remarkable legacy of the peace buildings, and therefore the international community, particularly Europe and the US, have become much more circumspect, has become much more suspect on the state discourse of branding the Gulen movement as a terrorist. And if the Gulen movement actually become a terrorist, then what is the use of the Islam and what is the use of the Islamic resources to fight the radical brand of the Islam, which is absolutely the plank of the West, that you need the moderate voice. You need the liberal voice. You need the other kind of the voice. And if this voice can be criminalized, if this voice can be branded as a terrorist, then which voice will be remain left that you will actually need for as a counter-terrorism discourse? That's the fundamental question that actually emerged. And therefore, what you find very interesting is that in the post-coup era, while so many dismiss another thing has been done in the name of the national crisis and the emergency law, the large number of people are not coming or not seeing that the democracies are very much in danger. That this rising wave of aggressive nationalism, the rising wave of authoritarianism, the democracy does not have. That democracy does not move when there is no critical discourse of a state. That democracy does not move when the state actually suppresses of any kind of civil society movement, be left, be right, be faith-based, or any kind. This actually raises the question whether the civil society can have any role in the expansion of democracy or in a relationship between the civil society and state. As a result, what happened is that you absolutely remove more than 1 lakh people. There's a complete administrative vacuum at the moment in Turkey. Since there is a complete administrative vacuum, this has led to large number of possible terrorist attacks. You know, Gaziantep happened, other happened, because the intelligentsia has, other places has been completely replaced by the other incompetent people actually, you know. So in a situation that you created this, you marginalized the civil society discourse, that the state would not be in a position, and therefore that the state is likely to become much more authoritarian and much more undemocratic in the future too, and that Turkey is likely to witness far more terrorist incidents that so far happened. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Can we open the floor for questions now?